When we move from a presumption of innocence to a presumption of guilt, we diminish our sense of community and undermine our democratic ideals.
Recorder, what's the exact location of your emergency?
1717 Ware Street.
Tell me something exactly what happened.
I don't know what's happening. I just had an older woman standing here, and she had noticed two gentlemen trying to get in a house at that number, 17 Ware Street.
You think they might have been breaking?
I don't know, because I have no idea.
Saying, you think the possibility might have been there?
I don't know if they had a key or not, because I couldn't see from my angle. But, you know, when I looked a little closely, that's when I saw...
Hispanic. Are they still in the house?
They're still in the house, I believe, yeah.
White, black, or Hispanic?
Well, there were two larger men. One looked kind of Hispanic, but I'm not really sure. And the other one entered, and I didn't see what he looked like at all.
Okay. Are you standing outside?
I'm standing outside, yes.
All right, we'll place her on the way.
We all had the strangest conversation with Crowley before he handcuffed. What did he say? He said, "Thank you for finally honoring my request. You're under arrest."
Do you know who I am? Do you know who I am? Do you know who I am?
We people who are darker than blue, are we gonna stand around this town and let what others say come true? We're just good for nothing, they all figure. A boyish grown up shiftless jigger. Now we can't hardly stand for that.
Lucia Whalen, the 911 caller in the Henry Louis Gates case, contradicts Cambridge police officer James Crawley's report. She denies telling him that she saw two black males with backpacks.
It started with the arrest of a Harvard professor in his own home, and the fracas hasn't really stopped. The woman who first called 911 about what she feared could be a break-in in progress could not have imagined what her phone call to police set in motion. We heard from her today. We're hearing from others as well. Our report tonight from NBC's Andrea Mitchell.
Hopefully soon we'll be...
Her call to police unwittingly triggered an incident that has ripped the scab off racial politics in America.
The criticism at first was so painful for me and difficult. I was frankly afraid to say anything. People called me racist and said I caused all the turmoil that followed. And some even said threatening things that made me fear for my safety. I knew the truth, but I didn't speak up right away. Because I did not want to add to the controversy.
Lucia Whalen, on a lunch break, called 911 to describe what she saw on that front porch in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
So I'm not sure if these are two individuals who actually work there, who live there.
You think they might have been breaking?
I don't know, because I have no idea.
Just the facts, and contrary to the police report, no mention of race. She said today her parents taught her to be kind to strangers.
And do not judge people based on race, ethnicity, or any other feature other than their character.
Much of what you heard on July 16, 2009, was an incomplete and certainly a misrepresented and ultimately a false story about what happened on July 16th, 2009.
The other thing which I find interesting is the fact that his neighbors didn't know him.
Most people, most thinking people, black and white, thought that it was wrong for Professor Gates to be arrested in his own home after having produced ID and everything else.
My father was so sad about this. And again, because he's always, my father might be one of the last black men on earth who actually believed in the justice system. You know, my father is a proponent of, you know, intellectualism can help you outrun the war on race. And I think the incident last week is a clear indication that that's not yet true.
It was interesting because one of the things your father said was, all I want is an apology from this guy.
Simple human apology.
And the officer in question has said, no way, no how.
Meanwhile, the police union is standing behind the arresting officer, Sergeant James Crowley, who's refusing Gates' request for an apology.
There will be no apology.
Is this now and ever no apology?
Yes.
I think the president should make an apology to all law enforcement personnel.
We have about 20 to 30 years of social science research which says very clearly that white folks, whether they're cops or just average citizens, will oftentimes view the behavior of black people as more negative, more dangerous, more aggressive, even more criminal than they would the very same behavior engaged in by a white person.
The arrest of Henry Louis Gates brought me to a level of such sadness that I sat down and wept. I thought, after all this, after living together in degrees of such intimacy, that we've taught each other how to care, how to love, how to nurse, how to mother, and yet here, on one of the intellectuals of our country, not black or white or male or female, just one of the intellectuals. Not only that, but also one of the participants in the education of our children. This man could be arrested for what? For what?
I would call it a confrontation between a police officer and a citizen in a citizen's home. There is no crime. There is no crime. And that made Barack Obama, in my estimation, not the president of the United States, but the black president.
Recently, Professor Henry Louis Gates Jr. was arrested at his home in Cambridge. What does that incident say to you, and what does it say about race relations in America?
I think it's fair to say, number one, any of us would be pretty angry. Number two, that the Cambridge police acted stupidly in arresting somebody when there was already proof that they were in their own home.
What kind of president of the United States immediately jumps on the police? This president, I think, has exposed himself as a guy over and over and over again who has a deep-seated hatred for white people or the white culture. I don't know what it is.
You can't say he doesn't like white people. David Axelrod's white. Rahm Emanuel's his chief of staff are white. I think 70% of the people that we see every day are white.
Glenn Beck said President Obama is a racist, and he hates white people. He was reprimanded, but his ratings went up. Why? Because it hit a target of people saying, we agree with Glenn Beck, right? The president has taken a side. And here's where the class issue becomes interesting. It's the side of the Harvard professor Gates, taken by the Harvard-educated president, President Obama, against the hard-working white working-class police officer, Sergeant Crowley.
The world does not care about black people. I think that just at every turn, you understand that you are not valued.
I had a reaction, speaking of gender and race, when I saw the beer summit. I got very anxious because I did think this was an opportunity for us to think about race in America. And I was quite anxious that it was in the hands of four men. And it wasn't that they were, you know, that I didn't believe that men could understand the race. But I also understand that women, each of us has at least one race, and that we have to be part of that conversation. It is not a conversation that is going to be resolved unless it is inclusive.
I called it beer for blood. I thought it was superficial and offensive to the number of black families who have lost their children to violence. I felt that it trivialized a kind of constructed, structured attack on black men in this country. One of my colleagues the other day told me that there's 68,000 black men in prison in New York State. And the president inviting them and their families to no picnic at the White House.
I was deeply disappointed with the handling of Gates' case by Obama. I think he was well-intentioned in his handling of it, but by inviting everybody to the White House for beers, he sent the message, he broadcast the message in a very teachable moment. He broadcast the message that this kind of profiling and discrimination by law enforcement is an interpersonal dispute that can be resolved through good, honest conversation over a few beers. And it's not true.
What I think we know, separate and apart from this incident, is that there is a long history in this country of African Americans and Latinos being stopped by law enforcement disproportionately. And that's just a fact.
If it had been another way around, say an African American called the police because somebody was trying to get into a house and they were white, would there have been the same degree and intensity of questioning? That's where I think the presumption of guilt comes in. Because Professor Gates was an African American, because of the stigma and the stereotype, particularly as it relates to black men, then automatically it must be something going on here.
As people of color, we move through the world very, very carefully because we know that at any time we can be looked at as guilty for something, guilty for just being black. In and of itself is an issue. And we don't really realize, I don't think we really realize the effect that has on us. And it has, I think, created a nation of us that are full of anger and rage and not really understanding why.
But the reality is that it tells us we've come a long way, but we have a much longer way to go. And I started with the Mount Pleasant case. As a reminder, I talk about Oscar Grant being killed and also being convicted in Oakland. I talked about Sean Bell in New York, Abner Wima, Abner Diallo. What's common is the color of their skin. They're born, worlds apart, but what's common is the color of their skin, which means that race, in many respects, trumps class, nationality, origin, religion, and that's the problem.
About something Malcolm said all those years ago. He said, a white man was asked, a racist was asked, what do you call black people? And he used the N-word. He said, well, but suppose you see somebody who is a president of the university. Who is he? He said, the N-word. He's just one with the... He said, suppose he's a doctor at Johns Hopkins and had done what an African-American doctor did do there, participate in the invention of the defibrillator, saving hundreds of thousands of lives. What would you call him? He said an N-word. And Malcolm said, but if I put my pistol on you, what would you call him? He said, I call him Mister.
Time and time again, you know, black people are racially profiled, black people are brutalized, and then the officers that are involved, they walk free. Look at the Amadou Diallo case. They shot Diallo 41 times, I think hit him 19 times. Nobody went to jail. Sean Bell shot 50 times. Nobody went to jail. But that's not justice. If black people kill somebody, they go to jail. And in states where there's a death penalty, they get the death penalty.
There are more African Americans under correctional control today, in prison, jail, probation, or parole, than were enslaved in 1850, a decade before the Civil War began.
When you take a 17-year-old and sentence him to 20 years for selling crack cocaine, that 17-year-old will not finish high school, will not have ability to get a job, will not be able to go to graduate school, will not be able to find a place to live, and will find himself at 37, still a young man, unable to become a productive member of society. We're condemning them to death. It's called life. But when you can't work, when you can't go to school, when you can't find a place to live, it's a sentence to death because it's a permanent disbarment from being part of the society. And I think that is the consequence of our wrong-minded and backwards criminal justice system. We don't rehabilitate. All we do is make them even more likely to perpetuate the same kind of behavior that put them in the criminal justice system from the beginning.
I mean that if you are pulled over, one has to recognize that your professional background, your economic status, your class absolutely means nothing, because you are now dealing with an individual who has authority, who has power, and has a weapon to back that power up. And depending upon your communications, your relationship, and how you and that person communicate can mean the difference between you moving on and you moving perhaps to jail or perhaps to a hospital or perhaps to a grave.
We may not have solved the problem either with what Dean Farmer talked about, we looked at a decade ago, or what we talked about with Rodney King almost 20 years ago. And I say that because I'm in New Jersey, but not very far away from where one of my clients, Brandon Cox, was shot less than 2 weeks ago by a Mount Pleasant police officer. And his friend, DJ Henry, was killed.
Even if it's true, my wife and I have said from the beginning, we want the whole truth. But at the end of the day, the central question to us is, does that justify killing our son? Our son is dead.
I said I've got a good mind to give up living and go shopping instead. To pick out me a tombstone, oh, and be pronounced dead.
I've had the chance to spend time with his best friend's family, both Denroy Henry, the father of DJ, and Angela Henry, the mother of DJ. And what I see is both the happiness and the sadness. The happiness is that they talk about DJ being mama's boy. They talk about the wonderful times they had playing games. They talk about sitting around the table like the Cosbys, like the Huxtable family, America's middle class. What could be better? Two working parents, every child in school, everybody's doing well. It was America's dream. And that's the great part. And then you talk about the tragedy. A kid who was in college, minding his own business, who had tattoos on his wrist saying family and first, who had the wings of angels tattooed on his back, who had chapters of verses of the Bible on his body, was a walking example of his spirituality that was reinforced by his mother and father. And now you see an emptiness, you see a distance, you see a pain, insufferable pain, when the parents have to understand what they can't understand. Why was our son killed? There is no explanation.
There is no thank you. There is no I'm sorry. There is no explanation. It's just a tragedy. And every time I see Angela in particular, I know you can see and feel the pain that she's going through. And it's not a momentary pain. It's not a daily pain. It's an endless pain, because every day she has to wake up and imagine she's in a nightmare. Imagine the DJ wasn't killed. Imagine that he's now a coach of some professional football team. Imagine that his younger sister and younger brother are now in college and going to graduate school. Imagine her and her husband are grandparents because DJ is a parent. And all of that she can only dream about. And the nightmare is that she won't have any of it.
My name is Angela Henry. I'm DJ Henry's mom, or to me I call him Danny. And I just want to thank everybody for their love and their support, their prayers. We also want to ask that you continue to support us as we search for the absolute truth regarding the taking of our son's life on October 17th. We, as a family, are grieving. We're trying to grieve. We're having a hard time because we don't know why our son was taken. And every day is a struggle. Every minute is a struggle. We just appeal to you to continue to support us as we look for the absolute truth.
We are still so thick, so slow. When will we learn? And that's my question. I know I'm not asking the camera, but I am asking America. I'm asking my fellow citizens, when will we drop this ignorance?
The officer who killed DJ Henry in a highly controversial shooting has been honored as Officer of the Year by the Pleasantville Police Benevolent Association.